requirements of the Open Public Meetings Act of the State of New Jersey have been satisfied by the inclusion of the date, time, and place of public meetings in a notice sent to the record in the Press Journal, April 29, 2010, filed with the Borough of Dumont, posted on the Dumont website, and the official bulletin board. Roll call. Councilman Carrick?
Here.
Councilman Manner?
Here.
Councilman Stiliano?
Here. Can I get a motion to accept the agenda as presented?
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Carrick, second by Manner. All in favor?
Aye.
Can I get a motion to approve the minutes of April 28, 2010?
So moved.
Offered by Councilman Manner. I'll second it. All in favor? Actually, can we get a roll call on that?
Councilman Carrick?
Yes.
Councilman Manner?
Yep.
Councilman Stiliano?
Yes. Okay, where we last left off, I guess the thought process was that Mayor McHale was going to bring some speakers to talk to us. Now, since then, we all attended, and I say we all, the people in this room attended a pay-to-play seminar that was given by the New Jersey Institute for Continuing Legal Education. And just ironically enough, that some of the speakers that Matt had expected to call to speak with us, they were presenting at the seminar. So to have them here for tonight would have been repetitive. So the thought process was that at this point, we've heard from everybody that we need to hear from, and now it's just a matter of putting pen to paper and coming up with something that makes sense for the town. I have, I guess, at a prior meeting, I took the Citizens Campaign Ordinance, the model ordinance, and I gave you what my thoughts were, what I wanted to see, and really what I didn't want to see in an ordinance, and I followed that up with a couple of emails, most recently today, and I really think that that's the way we need to approach it. Thank you.
Everybody has this.
Thank you, Kat. Actually, my email was copied, and it's in your packet. I think the way to approach it, what I'd like to do is really maybe have us think about what we want to see in an ordinance, what we don't want to see, what are our goals, and our objectives, and what don't we want? And we've seen enough, and we've read enough, and we've heard enough where, some towns take the position very liberally, some are extremely conservative, and do we want to stake a position out there with these towns, or do we want to find some middle ground? So what do we want to see? What don't we want to see? And my goal still is to really have something finalized by our next meeting and present it to the council in June. One of the things that you're all aware about or all aware of, come June, July, and August, we typically go down to one meeting. What I'd probably end up doing is calling a special session for the first week of June to present this to the council at an executive session, and then have this voted upon, discussed, debated at our second meeting in June. I want that to be the absolute deadline, and in my mind, there's really no reason to go beyond that. So, that being said, you all have, again, what I put down on paper last time, and I'll throw it out to you guys. What are you looking to do? What are you not looking to do based upon what we've seen and discussed? And what are your concerns and what are your objectives? Carl, why don't we start with you?
Okay. After that seminar, I believe that there is no one course or one direction that is the right direction. We've seen everything from talked about at that seminar. From the state's modified ordinance to the one-size-fits-all and to the total ban. So I think whatever we do, what we have to keep in mind when we present our findings to the council at large, they should recognize that there are options and that they should kind of talk about them. I think that that just providing with one document doesn't do justice after everything we've read and everything that we've experienced. I think what But I do believe that, you know, reform is needed. However, I think that, you know, going out in this manner is like building the house from the chimney down. And it's not the way it should be done. You know, proverbially going down the rabbit's hole. From the speakers that spoke at that seminar, you know, they all felt that, that what is in place now will be overturned at some point. Pay the value legislation, California's been overturned in the 9th District. Arizona, home of, you know, McCain, from McCain-Feingold, federal legislation has been overturned. So, you know, I think that there is no one right way of doing this. I think that we have to kind of piece it together, and I'll go back to what Matt said earlier on, that Citizens campaign document is there are things that, don't fit here.
Right.
You know, I think that, we have to kind of figure it out and, work through it. You know, if we're going to violate the Constitution, the First Amendment, the state's Constitution, Article 1, Section 5, then I would say you don't bolster the law and, make it a total ban and you have a dollar, for, you know, dollar in, dollar out, you know, reporting. Because if it's going to get overturned, it should get overturned for the right reason. And, if we're going to do a half and half, or quarter and half, or three quarters and one quarter, you know, people are still going to scratch their head. You know, what does it all mean? And so, you know, I read through your document. I think that even in the state's document, you know, they questioned $300 as being sanity. You know, they also tied to cost of living index, so that should go up as the cost of living goes up. So, you know, again, what we had talked about originally about $300, what is it? What does it say? You know, you got to kind of question that. You know, so I don't know if that's the right number. You know, some towns use 600 or 500. You know, I don't know, but I think yes. If you want to talk about one aspect as a threshold, dollar threshold, we should talk about a dollar threshold. The other thing, though, that you have over here, and I agree with, is the dollar report. Mm-hmm. I think that that's truly addresses transparency, and I think that if you do that, you know, everybody's kind of playing the same playing field. And also, I would tie into that in-kind contributions.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, in-kind contributions are hit or miss if they're reported or if they're not.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I think that has to be something that has to be considered. So, you know, right now, that's what I see initially.
Okay.
You know, starting out. Obviously, as we get through this, and if you want to use the Citizens campaign as a model, what I would suggest is breaking it down into the component pieces and then putting our own spin on the component pieces. You know, I don't believe that using this, like Mr. Carlone said and a couple of the other speakers, one size fits all is the right thing. And we already said that. We don't kind of agree with that. So, you know, I guess we have to look at what fits Dumont and what best fits the people of Dumont.
Mm-hmm.
And then go off from there.
Well, just before I turn it over to you, Matt, my thoughts with starting with the model ordinance was that, I mean, we're not reinventing, or we shouldn't look to reinvent the wheel. You know, you have something that's in place, you have something that really is the basis, it provides the basis for ordinances pretty much throughout the state, you know, at whatever it was, 80 or 100, or, you know. So I don't know that, you know, and this is, you know, this is why I really started with this, because it does provide, you know, it sort of like that, you know, the basis point for, you know, and you can tailor it or modify it to what makes sense. Now, do we want to, I think where we start is, do we want to restrict contributions to state, county? I heard a great line, and you guys heard it too, at the seminar. There's a hair's breadth difference between a campaign contribution and a bribe. I think that's a great line. Now, am I going to be influenced if somebody gives $600 to some state senator down in, you know, wherever, Belmar? I'm not. I don't really care. I mean, I only care about what goes on in Dumont. And that's, you know, I think that's where you really, we really need to start. Who do we want to restrict and how? As far as dollar amount, I picked $300 only because, one, it's in the, you know, that's the reporting threshold. But more importantly, I was concerned about monitoring in-kind contributions. If you've got somebody who, as an example, delivers literature for you, you know, and you have a zero, you know, zero in or, you know, $0, but they do something that's ministerial or nominal, do we want to disqualify them as a professional or someone that we can hire if they are truly the most qualified? I'm not going to be influenced, you know, and I hope nobody else on the dais is going to be influenced over a $300 contribution. To me, that's not going to be the turning point for me, or that's not going to be, you know, something that's going to be a decision maker. Someone gives me $100,000, is that going to subconsciously, you know, affect my decision? Yeah, I mean, it's very possible, you know, that subconsciously you might look at their application a little bit more favorably. But for $300, it's nominal. And I'm also sensitive to what the speakers said, and you know, what's been said in this room. It does take money to run a campaign, and, you know, I'm sensitive to that. Do I agree necessarily that should be taken into consideration? I only take it into consideration because, you know, people that know a lot more about this than I do said we should take it into consideration. But that's why I picked the $300 threshold. My concern about trying to monitor in-kind contributions that have a $10 value and then disqualifying potentially qualified firms over an in-kind contribution where you're subjectively, not objectively, dollar, you know, $300 is $300, and that's objective, but when you're trying to subjectively place a dollar number on an in-kind contribution, and again, $300 for me is not going to influence me, and it hasn't influenced me. I've had professionals give me more than that, and I've still voted no. I'm glad we're on board with the reporting requirements. You know, dollar is reported. I have no problem with that. One of the issues we need to discuss and come to grips with, and I'm struggling with it, and I'm trying to hear both sides of it, is retroactive versus prospective. Something that's, you know, I know that I'm probably in the minority when I said we should go retroactive, and I understand the arguments, and certainly we should have an open mind about that. The other issue is wheeling. You know, we need to talk about that, and then the constitutionality, as you pointed out, Carl. The people on the dais felt that at some point if challenged, these municipal ordinances are all going to fall by the wayside in light of the citizens' case that was recently decided. Now, while that case was by the U.S. Supreme Court, not directly on point in dicta, the court made some comments that, you know, anyone challenging these municipal ordinances is going to use to their advantage. And what Carbone, the speaker, said, he felt that the truest form of free speech is supporting a candidate and doing it financially. And if you're going to, you know, impede upon that or affect someone's right to do that, that you might get yourselves into hot water. So knowing that constitutionality may be an issue, I'm sensitive to it, but it's never been a reason for me not to do something that some court down the line.
I don't disagree with you. All I'm saying is that we should be going into this knowing that.
Sure.
And I think that the council needs to go into this knowing that.
Right.
And that's a real issue. I mean, you know, citizens who married in 2006.
Right.
Speech now, the Thalma decision, and the Thalma decision, which they use as reference points in their presentation,
right,
all points to the fact that, by restricting participation, limiting participation, or outright banning participation, in effect, and I'm not a constitutional scholar, but this is what they're saying. It's an extension of free speech, you know, by outlawing people to participate.
Right.
You're violating their right, you know. So I think that, you know, whatever we wind up doing, the preamble or the base of this whole thing, people have to understand that, you know, there are questions about the constitutionality and legality of doing this. And that's why, you know, I think that there will be the question asked of, not so much on contributions, but how the separate entities, whether the political action committees, whether the political parties, the committees, or the like, how are they using their money to influence a campaign? And you know, they brought up the overturning of Executive Order 7.
Right.
You know, where you cannot just arbitrarily identify a group and prejudice that group and say you can't participate.
Right.
You know, so you know there are so many layers that they were dealing with that, you know, people have to understand that, you know, trying to do the right thing doesn't mean it's the correct thing.
Right. Well, why don't we talk, turn it over to Matt, and then we'll get to a more, because I have some thoughts on that as well, but before I respond, Matt, what do you have to say about
it? Kind of like costing something with the building the chimney. When you frame a house in raw cape cards, they all look the same from the outside. The walls and stuff may be the same, it's about what you put into it. It's what couch you pick, or what couch you pick, or what couch I pick. It's, everything's a little different. So you got to put pieces in there that's going to work. We'll start with a piece of framework, and then go from there. Like you said, pick and choose what we think will work, which is fine. Freedom of speech, I think it's great. I have it all day long, freedom of speech, but put a price on it then. $300, you can back any candidate you want. $300, $500, I'm even $200, I have $500 to find too with me. It's not gonna change my way of voting, all right? I don't, if all our engineers or whatever are giving the same amount of money now, and we have some other engineers who are out there, when RFP time comes up, we feel they're better, then they're on the same equal playing field. You know, because nobody can put in $2,600 and this guy put in $3,000. And he said, well, the $2,600 guy looks great. But you keep a number, it's flat. Everybody's working the same way. Very well, Carl, it could be turned over. But you know, we started something. I feel very strong about it. If I lose, you know, when these people decide to turn it over, overturn the thing, then okay. But I know we did the right thing. I know I did the right thing. I can't speak for everybody, so don't get me wrong. It's not something wrong. We're trying something. I think it's going to be even. Everybody's got to raise the same amount of money. You're right, it costs money for a campaign. After going home last time, David, you telling me about envelopes, and I didn't even think about the amount of stamps, what it costs to run stamps. You know, and if we put out 3 pieces of literature a year, everybody's going to put out something. We've got to have something to back it up with. I mean, I'm sitting back right now telling me that I owe money from last year that I didn't know about. And I didn't know it even cost that kind of money. But now I'm learning. I'm catching up pretty quick. Take me a little bit of time. I thought that meeting was very good. I wasn't all for the last speaker. I can't even think of what it was. He seemed one way on that. I thought the girl that spoke very well. She had a lot of heart into it. The story the guy told about going to the bar and buying a drink for somebody, and you know, that's a contribution.
Right.
Come on. That's a little out of hand, but we have 3 pretty smart people here. I think between the 3 of us, we can come up with something that works. Matt has his input, Matt's been around a long time. Probably has more input than all of us because he deals with this every day. The mayor picked us 3 to do the committee. We're to come up with something we feel it works, and we present it to the council. If the council doesn't like what we present and they want to vote it down, fine, but we can't go back in and say, let's make some more changes because they didn't like this, they didn't like that. Go ahead.
No, that's why, like I said at the beginning, you know, there are different paths we can take. We can be very stringent, nothing, and $1 contribution. We could do a modification, pick and choose, and mix and match like the citizens, based on the citizens' campaign document. Or we can go back and look at what the state has changed and modify the existing ordinance to coincide with the state ordinance. So there are different ways to go. And like I said, I think that whatever we come up with, the council needs to know that there are other options. Like you said, if they say, well, we don't like this, we'll say, fine, you know, there are other, you know, these are the three options. You cannot just say no to all of it. I mean, you know, there's got to be some sort of buy-in on one, two, or none of them. You know what I'm saying? So I think that's part of what we need to do to educate them as far as what we learn in the process. You know, we can say we think this is the best of the three, but I think that they need to know that there are other avenues that we want to look at.
There is so many other options that I said I wouldn't do it, but I started looking into those books, and I got a freaking headache after doing the school budget thing too.
Right.
There's 1,000 pages of that, and I don't know how many pages of them were captured.
About 1,000.
I don't have time in the bathroom to read all of them. There's so many avenues. We've got to try to pick an avenue that we, as a group, feel comfortable. And I just feel that if they're not happy with it, the council, the remaining people, then they're either going to vote no, or they're going to say, okay, I do agree with this, yes. And you can tell them, oh, those who say, you can say the same thing, well, there are as many options, please read this through and think about it. I'm agreeing with Harry too, I'd like to get this done. I really told him I would love to get it done before the primary, before this all started. And I feel since this is going into the 2010 campaign, that it should go back to January 1st, 2010 and run through the year. That this is the way it should work, because this is the year we're working on this project. Just like anything, I mean, you can go back and figure out real quick with the school budget and these teachers and their retroactive pay. I mean, they want it to go backwards too, if they get it. You know, they don't want to just get their raise starting the day their contract signs. They want their money back. So I
that's
don't feel as
negotiation.
What?
That's a negotiation.
It's a negotiation, yes.
It may or may not. Yeah.
It may or may not, but that's the route they're really supposed to. They're supposed to go back and get their retroactive if they do get it. So to me, starting in January 1, 2010. I'm fine. And I think everybody should have the same equal playing field. And I, like I said before, every professional, anybody wants to donate money, should be at the same level. We shouldn't be able to, and that's why I didn't agree with Citizens Campaign, or the young lady from Fairlawn, was it, who said that any of the professionals who work now could not donate. Because we have some very talented professionals at the moment that we know of. And who's to say that next year we don't get another professional who's done some fantastic work in the state of New Jersey, and we're able to look at their work, we'll look at their RFQ and say, well, you know what, these guys seem to be a lot better.
Well, here's my thoughts on, and I understand the argument of constitutionality, and, you know, I think there is a risk that at some point it's going to be overturned. It's funny, I sat in this very room two or three years ago with Bob Zettlinger, and we had a debate over pay to play, and I told him back then, I said, I really have some serious concerns over whether something like that would be constitutional, and I still have those concerns. I mean, and the fact that Christie's executive order got stricken, and the fact that a Supreme Court case came down the way it did, and the fact that municipal ordinances at the municipal or the city level in certain jurisdictions have already been stricken, it only adds to that. But that being said, we all understand, and like you say, we'll explain it to the council what the risks are. If it gets overturned, then you're back to where you started as far as I'm concerned, unless somebody challenges it directly in Dumont, puts us in a position where we have to defend it, and then you have the risk of, potentially, spending money on professional or attorney fees to defend. But if it's challenged, my opinion is that if somebody's going to challenge it, it's not going to be a middle-of-the-road middle ground type of an ordinance. They're going to look for the most conservative ordinance in the state, and that's the one they're going to attack. So if it's attacked and it's overturned and it's an across the board strike on municipal ordinances, we're no worse off than when we started the down the path. As far as why and Matt, you just hit on something that went into my thought process. Why do I think 300, the in-kind contribution, the monitoring of that, but yeah, the panelists did say, you know, you're at a bar and some professional buys you a drink, or some professional takes you, you know, buys you dinner, you know, and it has, it's like a $10, you know, $10 drink. Is that a contribution? And if you've got zero contribution, that's a threshold, zero, does that now disqualify that firm? And the panel was not sure about that, so.
Well, the question I was asked, who's getting the money? The answer was the bartender.
Well, the bartender, but who's getting the benefit of that payment, and that was the candidate.
Yeah, again, you know, it wasn't just one drink, you put a round of drinks, so.
Right. But if you
said how far down the chain, if I give you a pencil, what does that mean?
It gets silly, yeah.
That's why I did not agree with what he had to say. I thought he was just going far fetched.
But he was making the point how obtuse it gets, you know, how crazy it gets. You know, where do you draw the line and say, you know, enough?
So what if, this is what got me to thought about it. If you're out to dinner with your wife and you're having a nice little dinner and you sit in the bar, and one of our professionals, who happens to be a friend of ours, not just a professional, says, would you mind doing me a favor, send over a drink to that table? Now what is he, for a bottle?
Yeah.
What has he done to you now?
And that's really where it can get...
Well, you know, I'll relate to that because when I worked on the floor, we had very strict limitations on what you could and couldn't accept, you know, and it came down to the fact that, you know, most of us grew up together. We went to each other's weddings, we went to our children's baptisms, you know. I mean, that kind of relationship is very close. The question that came down, that the vice president's role was a specialist, was a broker. So now when she was out with her brother, she had to report that. And Leo came back and said, well, no, but they didn't give a definite no. You know, he said, well, no, that's stupid. You know, he's still broke. He's still overseeing and monitoring and surveilling his transactions. So the issue finally wound up that your department head would sanction or not sanction. Most of our meetings were breakfast meetings. Now, I would host the meeting. But invariably, the people that I took to the breakfast would pick up the tab. You know, weren't illegal with that. Said, well, you know, what are you talking about? Eggs. Okay. The coffee. Okay. Toast. Okay. So, fine, you can do that. Same thing with lunch meetings. What came to the point was tickets. Baseball games. If you aren't being accompanied by partners, you gotta either pay the cost of the ticket, plus report. 9 times out of 10, again, the relationships were so close and overlapped that, and once you reported it, you know, it was filed, that was it. So, you know, I would suspect eventually that's where we would wind up with this. And like you say, going out to dinner or getting a drink, you know, if you do your due diligence or report it, let the ethics board decide whether or not, you know, it was the right thing or the wrong thing.
But that's
a zero.
Limit.
And that's why I think you get silly. You know, and they gave those kinds of outrageous examples.
Absolutely.
To make a point. But if you keep it at 300, like I said, I don't think that's what citizens' campaign suggests. 300 is not going to influence anybody in this room, I would hope. And
you know how I feel about $300. That's
arbitrary.
You can pass through how many $250 donations on the $300. That's the whole point of doing zero.
But if it's cumulative, then it's gonna, you know.
So they take it to the max. Report it to state statute. Now what?
But now we're gonna be more restrictive at the local level. We're gonna keep it at 300. And it's cumulative, so they can't give you, you know, $250 contributions. And we're gonna prohibit, you know, like the model ordinance does, siblings and spouses and, you know, to try to listen, it's never going to be perfect.
I'm
guarantee
it.
I'm just saying,
$300. What do you? I mean, I agree with you, but that'll back. You know,
it's nothing. But it takes out all of this other, you know, nonsense from coming into the equation. All of, you know, I bought you a drink, or I, you know, sent you a bottle, or, you know, listen, I buy my own drinks. But I mean, that's besides the point. But if somebody,
so let me ask you this: professional sends a basket, holiday time.
Right.
Yours.
Better not have a value over $300.
How would you know?
No. But that's objective. What'd you pay for it? And is he sending it to me? Is he sending it to me or to the staff?
He sends it to the council. Also, he sends it to the council.
I never got a fruit basket. My 5 years on the council, 4 years on the council.
And the council do want this.
I must have been absent that day, because I never saw it. But if he sends, you know, if, as long as it doesn't have a value of over $300 to one specific person, then he's fine. He can't be sending lavish gifts. You know, but if you have a zero, and that goes, you know, that actually works against your point, because if you have a zero threshold and he sends a basket, it could have a value of $10, and then what?
Send it back.
Wow.
Very simple.
Well, you can send it back if...
Say thank you, we can't sell it.
Listen, we can have...
I got a little option, so I know. You can do that.
By the way, I think, just to take a step back, I think the way we present this to the council, our job, it's the committee's job to come up with a final proposed ordinance, not to go in with, well, you know, suggestion, you know, we could do this, because you're never going to get this done. You're going to have debate among six people, and that's going to take us into, you know, into next year.
I don't particularly agree with you. I think you need to be educated to know that there are different options that were available, and each side can do something like
but
this.
You picked three people who you thought would do the right job, the council people, the mayor picked. Before we even knew this was even coming into it, back in January, these are the three people on my ordinance committee, because I think they're going to do the best job. And what we did is we came up with something, and between the three of us, we feel this is the best. Do I want you to chew it apart and tell me to go back to the table and do it again? No.
But you can give them their options. You give them what we consider to be a final version, and you can present to them what our concerns are with the constitutionality. You can say, listen, there were a number of different avenues we could have taken, and this is what we ultimately came up with. And is there going to be debate on the issue? Absolutely. Is there going to be a split vote on this? Absolutely. But that's fine. I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. But at the end of the day, if we can get four people to agree with us that this is the right thing to do, then we're done and we move on to the next thing until we have to revisit this. But I just don't think we go in with, you know, our notes and say, well, this is what we can do and what do you guys suggest? No, I mean, we're running this. This is our project, and then we present it to them when it's finalized.
I'm not questioning that. Mm-hmm. I think that part of our responsibility is to let them know and educate them.
No doubt.
That this is not the only thing out there. That there are, like you said, there are variations. You go into the book, pick a half dozen, you have a half dozen variations. And that's, I think, part of what we need to do as educating the rest of the council.
Right, but we considered those variations, and this is what we came up with. And now, if they want to say, well, listen, I really feel that 300 is too restrictive, and it should really be 600, you know, let, and they can, you know, we'll listen to them. We'll listen to the debate and to the argument. And at the end of the day, if changes have to be made because we can't get four people to agree to it in the form that we present, then, you know, then we go back and we modify as we see fit.
Why would we have to go back? Because even if we got a 3-3,
we
would turn it over to the mayor, and the mayor would do it. So we could also turn it over. It could be four no's, two yeses.
Right.
There's no need to go back and take this thing and redo it again, rehash it.
Well, if it's turned down, we're going to have to come back because the commitment was to get a pay-to-play ordinance on the book.
Well, there's some people that I know in polling and you know, polling the council that are just so opposed to the concept of any ordinance. And I don't think it matters what's in the particular ordinance. 300, zero, you know, reporting, it doesn't matter. So I think you're not, unless those people have had a change of heart, then they're going to be a no anyway. But if there's a specific provision out of the, you know, 10 or 12 paragraphs that we put before the council that they want tweaked, you know, then we'll listen to them. But I think we put the finalized version. I'm going to be ready to defend whatever the document that we put before the council and justify, you know, why it's there. And hopefully we can get the four votes. You know, and that's all we can do. You know, we can only put what we feel is the best product based upon, you know, and it goes to like the school board. You know, I'll use that as an analogy. I sat in that meeting last night not knowing what the three members on the committee knew because they were immersed in this, just like we're immersed in this. You know, I don't think that any other council person has taken the ordinances from the 100 or so towns that are in place and have taken courses and have educated themselves. So they're not going to know as much about this topic as we do at this point. And I can tell you, I know a heck of a lot more about this topic today than I did 2 months ago or even 2 weeks ago, because we've been dealing with this day and night. So, but I think it's at some point, it's time the fish are cut bait, and I think we put something together that we think is best based upon all of our research and all of our time committed to this. And if they don't like it, and we can't get 4 votes, and, you know, then, you know, that's, you're not going to win every battle. And I'm hoping to win this one, but, you know, if we can't convince 4 people, then, you know, then, and their minds are, their no vote is irrevocable, then that's all you can do. You know, I'll sleep at night like a baby knowing that we did our best. I'm pretty confident we're going to get 4 votes. So, we'll just wait and see. But I think we present what we think is best, you know, and educate them and provide them, you know, or let them know that we considered a lot of alternatives and let them know what those alternatives were and see what we can do about convincing, you know, 4 people on that dais. You agree? All right, so you guys have my notes. I think what we need to really, how are you with the reporting requirements? You know, Carl and I seem to be on the same page with you contribute a dollar or if you receive a dollar or...
Well, you report everything.
You report everything. Okay, Carl, you're okay with that? I mean, let's see what we have common ground at least. On the retro versus prospective, I'm the one that raised January 1st, 2010 as the start date. I've polled the council individually, and I've gotten a lot of pushback. I understand the argument on the other side. It's sort of the best analogy I got was Madison Avenue, 25 mile an hour speed limit. I'm caught on radar, you know, doing 25 miles an hour a week ago. It's fine, legal. We changed the law. The council changes the law. Well, assuming it's not a county road, and we said, you know what? We only want 50 miles an hour. The maximum speed limit is 15 miles an hour. And we're going to make it retroactive to a month ago. Should I now be ticketed for following the law or penalized for following the law as it existed at the time I was committing the act? And I mean, it's a good argument. I think that's something we need to really think about. You know, I felt retroactive to January 1st was the right move. I'm still struggling with it. I'm not convinced that it's not, but it's something, let's think about that.
Well, is there something went on at January 1st to today that oversees that?
Excuse me 1 minute. Hello. Hey, Stephen, I'm in a meeting. What's up?
I'm me.
Crisis to a 12-year-old.
He's 13.
13 as of last week.
I know your own kid's age and you don't. Problems here, Harry.
That's because he's your infielder.
So what do you do? Was there something done that's over the limit already? Has stuff been already put in?
The only thing, well, I know that from what I understand, professionals have contributed over the limit since January, and from what Matt said at one meeting, there was a contribution, a $500 contribution to Freeman. I haven't independently verified that, and from what I've subsequently learned, there was a contribution for a few thousand to Ellen and to one other individual, to Carl, okay. So now do we penalize whoever contributed to Freeman and to them because they were following the rules at the time? I mean, we don't have to come up with an answer now. Within the next couple of days, let's think about it and figure out whether or not we want to penalize or make it retroactive, which would disqualify whoever
these were. It's just so funny that you said Freeman. He's never run it. Why would he take the money in so early in his campaign?
He started for his next campaign.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know that to be a fact. I'm trying to deal with the concept, not with the specifics. You know, whether contributions were made or not made.
Well, you know, you can't make a law.
Right.
And make it retroactive. Because I think it does a disservice to the whole concept of putting the law into place to begin with. If you're going to start from a start date, you start from the day that law is enacted, going forward. Everything we do is 20 days after the council votes on it. So, you know, to do this is like contrary to what we do to begin with.
I get it. I understand. You know, listen, being an attorney and dealing with laws and dealing with statutes and dealing with court rules, you know, I'm trying to put myself in the opposite. You know, it's just my training forces me to look at both sides of an issue. And I always look, the reason why I've had success in the courtroom is because I've always not looked at things from my perspective or my client's perspective, because I know what my position is. It's always looking at things from the opposite perspective. And looking at things on this issue from the opposite perspective, it's an issue of fairness. I get it, I understand it, I haven't fully come to grips with it yet. So I understand what you're saying. You know, it's these were the rules, these are currently the rules until this goes into place. And this happens, you know, apparently Freeman had his thing in January. These contributions were made in January, you know, 7 or 10 days after. So, you know, is it fair to penalize a professional, disqualified professional, for making the contribution 6 months before an ordinance was put into place? I understand it. I don't know how I'm going to come out, how I'm going to rationalize it. I think I know which way I'm going to go, but I just have to, I'm not ready to commit to one way or another yet. I have to give it some more thought. So that's really the both sides of the argument. You know, make it retroactive to a specific date. You know, you may take out some qualified people, disqualify some qualified professionals for doing something that at the time was perfectly within the ground rules. And if I'm in their shoes, how do I?
And you leave yourself open for, you know, if they want to pursue it, legal action.
Yeah, no.
You know that. I'm not telling you, you don't know that. You have a law better than I do.
Yeah, I mean, let's give it some thought, and, you know, let's see where we come out with it. And I don't know that I'm, you know, I think if one thing would defeat or would prevent us from getting 4 votes in speaking, you know, I'm still waiting to hear back, because I do call on these issues. One thing that would probably prevent us from getting the 4 votes that we need would be that retroactive versus prospective. And this is going to be a tight vote based upon the conversation that I've had. You know, no one's out now said I'm for it or against it, but, you know, you can sort of read people. This is going to be, if this does get the votes, it'll just be the amount that we need. This is not going to be 6-0. This is not going to be 5-1. I think if it does get the votes, it's going to be 4-2. So, all right, let's give that some thought and come to some consensus. Dollar amount. Think about, you know, what's been said, what you've heard, what you've read, and let's come up with a dollar amount. And, I mean, for me, I think the right number, for the reasons that I've already laid out, is 300. It's not going to, you know, it's not going to sway anybody. It shouldn't sway anybody to hire an incompetent professional. It's what the model provides for, what the model ordinance provides for. It's what a lot of the other jurisdictions have done, and we did read those for a reason. And it does prevent some of the, you know, some of the nonsense from coming into the equation, like the drink that's bought at, you know, at a dinner or a bottle.
That's the reason I went to the 3 and even thought 5. I mean, there's a number of other towns that went 5, 750, 1250.
Right.
But, and we said this in the last meeting, 0. And I kind of agree with that. Then after hearing that guy's statement, it's not right. 0 is not. From what I had agreed to last month, I had said something about 0. I don't feel that that's fair, because I don't feel like I'm walking into some place and somebody does buy me a drink, and I don't think like that. It's just not. You want to donate money? You want to contribute money to a check, to a fundraiser, dollar in? Yes, we report every dollar that goes in, everywhere. You want to rent out, for what I'm understanding, you wanna rent that headquarters, make sure you got paperwork to back it up, okay? And we all know where it's coming from then, okay? So I keep saying to everybody, this has gotta be an even playing field. And on one side, having more than the other. You know, I always thought that to get an elected official, you should've been a popular person. It's not who had more money, but except for listening to Bloomberg in the city, we get into three terms, but.
And John Corzine?
And Corzine, but you know what? If people like you, they like you. And he said it to me a couple months ago, you know what? If I win, I win. If they liked me, then they voted for me. If they don't like me, then I'm out.
I don't have a ton of money.
Huh?
But I'll have more free time on my hands. It forces somebody to run on their record and on their reputation as opposed to, you know, sending out five mailings. And it forces everybody to play on the same playing field. And you know, even with contributions now for those that have offered to contribute to my campaign. By the way, you know, this affects me, you know, and I'm glad I'm running this year, because this affects me more than any other council person, except for Ellen, who's also running, and who's ever opposing us. And it's not like, you know, I would be the biggest hypocrite if I ran last year and took oodles of money and said, you know what, now that I'm in, I'm gonna restrict anyone else from getting money. This affects me directly and immediately, and more so than anybody else, because I'm running this year. So, I mean, who better to pitch this and push for this than someone who's directly affected?
Yeah, when you throw the word hypocrite out there. I was the guy that ran last year and still didn't know what that was all about.
I understand.
And it was there and we spent money and
I'm doing this
because I just thought honestly, last year I thought it was all being done on both sides. Everybody was raising money for campaigns. And then when I find out one guy uses this and the next guy uses that number.
Right.
I was misled. Maybe I wasn't misled, maybe I was naive.
Well, you know, but listen, you know, I always thought running for council, you know, there's a lot more to it than meets the eye. And there's reporting requirements, there's filing requirements, there's, you know, the raising of the money, there's putting together the literature. I mean, there's a whole strategy to it, which, you know, I always thought, oh, let me just put my name on a ballot and shake hands and tell people what I'm about. And really, that's what I'm trying to get this to, you know, because hearing what's been spent, you know, over the years to win a local election or to run for council or whatever, a local position is obscene. I mean, it really is. And this is gonna force both sides to really win and run on their reputation, their qualifications, and their record. And that's gonna be the same for both sides. It's not like one side's gonna be able to do anything over and above what the other side does, you know, unless they are able to get a lot of $300 contributions or a lot of private contributions or unless they self-fund.
That's the lady back in Fairmont.
What, right.
Raised $39,000 to run the campaign. It's
a
money for professional. In a hot tub.
And yeah, her hot tub party.
And then the mayor who raised $120,000 to a campaign. But.
So, you know, I think the reasoning is we're all on pretty much the same page, you know, for the reasoning behind it. But now we just have to hammer out provisions. And what I'd ask you guys to do is really over the next couple of weeks, maybe the next 10 days or so, think about, put something down as I have done, you know, and present it, and let's see where we have that common ground, and let's see where we're apart, you know, where we don't have common ground. Let's hash out those areas where, you know, where we're not on the same page, and come to some consensus, and put something before the council. And you know, again, I'm not being disrespectful, and I understand we're all passionate, but this is never going to be 100% ironclad perfect. It's just not, and I don't think we should look for perfection. We look for something that's the best under the circumstances. As you said, you've got three minds in here. I think three pretty smart people that are not always going to agree, and let's just find where we do agree and hash out where we don't, and let's put something before the council and see what they want to do with it. You know, just, you've got my email, you've got, you know, you've got what I've said, and I think mine's ready to go. I mean, it's just now I'm waiting here from you guys as to where, you know, where we're consistent and where we're not. Colin? Matt?
Are we hashing anything out tonight?
Well,
or are we just?
Well, you see where I'm at. You see I think 300 is the right number. You know, I think we're not going to hash out retro versus prospective tonight. Give it some thought. I think that's the big issue. And don't only think about what, you know, what we want here, but also whether or not that's going to carry 4 votes. You know, maybe talk to the council people yourself independently. Wheeling, the issue of wheeling, where I'm at is no wheeling in and out, period, of Dumont accounts. You know, my focus was on Dumont candidates. I don't, you know, I don't really care what they're doing at the state. I don't care what they, I really don't care. You know, if I've got a professional contributing to a state senator, it's not going to affect me. You know, and it goes back to that line, a contribution versus a bribe. Is that going to affect my decision-making in Dumont because some senator is getting, you know, $5,000 or whatever from some professional firm, or somebody gave the opponent of someone that I supported $5,000. It's not going to affect me. I'm only concerned about what's going on here.
I don't think that was the issue, Harry. I think the issue was that money was coming through these different entities
right.
into the local accounts.
Right.
So it does affect you.
But I don't want, what I'm saying is that I want there to be...
But you wouldn't, you see, again, my question is, how would you know this? If you're accepting a check from Paul Sorrell,
mm-hmm.
how do you know the check's from Paul Sorrell? Or from the Carpenters Union, or from the Communications and Boards of America? That's my point. I mean, how do you, as we said on tracking in kind, how do you track that? I mean, you know how many hundreds of thousands of dollars goes back and forth? I understand the concept. Don't get me wrong. I understand the concept. But how do you distinguish now that check from Solo is not from CWA?
Well, my assumption is he's not going to be cutting a personal check to me. I mean, he's just not.
But you know what I'm driving at.
I understand.
And the same thing, you know, Kenny had contributions from Charlotte and from Cardinale.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's in out of their accounts. They can't pay it now. They come out of personal change accounts. You know what I'm saying? So how do you know where that money came from? Unless you can say we know where that money's coming from. I don't know how you make the delineation.
There's two sides to wheeling. One is wheeling in and one is wheeling out. So as far as wheeling out, there's no mystery there. There's no investigation that needs to be done. So if we say no wheeling out, if somebody contributes to me, that's my money to use, period. And if I don't
use... Let me ask you this.
Sure.
If you need money to finish running your campaign,
right.
and I have money in my account,
right.
you won't accept my money.
If it came from an outside source, I'll accept your money, but I'm not going to accept...
Not from my campaign, because I'm not running for another year.
My opinion is that is nothing more than a vehicle to exceed the $300 limit that we've imposed. That's my opinion. So if let's say Corporation A gives me $300, and that's the limit, and now you're saying to me, well, I've got $300 from Corporation A as well, I'm going to give it to you because I'm not running this year. Well, why are they giving it to you in the first place unless it's to give it to me? So now we've got a $300 restriction or cap that means nothing because we're allowing them through the back door to give me $600. So no, I don't want that money. I don't want that money.
If I'm going to donate to your campaign, just to let it be real perfectly clear, it's going to come out of my personal account this year.
You mean your
my account, my money that my personal is $300. Mm-hmm. It will be $300 to you and then $300 to Ellen. It'll come out of my own account, my own personal account. It's not going to come out of my campaign. Well, my campaign account's got $2 in it. I can't write a check without bouncing.
Well, you can give me whatever you want because you're not going to do work for the town.
But I'm still going to give you them.
So you can
dig
into that pocket, my
like
friend.
Everybody else is doing, which is, we also want to be honest.
$5.
You
can't
give me $5.
Much more than I buy him a cup of coffee at times.
So I said, $5.
But you know what to say? Hey, everybody's going to have to stick with the $300. If it's a CWA, the guy Paul, or whatever else is $300. It's not $2,800. And same as he just said, there's no reason that he should get more money donated from A. And you get money donated from A, and you don't need the money, so you give it to him.
Well, suppose I don't get money from A.
Huh?
So suppose I don't get money from A. Then we have 13 or 15 vendors.
Right.
And I might get the same contribution from the contributions that he's received from the same vendors.
Okay.
So that still eliminates it?
I feel so. I feel if you want to donate, if I want to donate, I'm going to donate out of my own personal account. I'm not going to donate it out of somebody else that gave me money to run an account, a campaign for 2011, say if I was running. I don't want to use that money to give to him. No, that's for me to use when my time is there.
I kind of disagree because, you know, like I told you before, when I was a union person, we would get calls from hand phones, stuff envelopes, make contributions, you know, and that money went into the local, and the local distributed it to whomever they needed to distribute it to. So that's the same concept. So, you know, if we say that that's not right, then that's not right at many different levels across the board. And then you give to a charity. You give to a charity, unless you specify where you want that money to go, they'll use it wherever they want. And the same thing as a campaign account. That money comes into a campaign account. It's the campaign, the person whose name is on that campaign account to make the decision whether or not he wants to direct that money to another candidate or not.
Why did the money go to your campaign account?
Why not?
Why did Mr. Chen over there say, I want to give Carl $300?
He could.
Because I want Carl to have that $300 for when he runs, not for Carl to get the $300 to give it to Harry. Keep your money, keep your account, run your own. Okay. I'm just saying, Carl, we said this last month, we're making this fair. We want to be honest people. That money that's in your account is for Carl Manor to run in 2011. That's it. I don't feel any money should be taken out of your, of my account, say it was now, and given to somebody else to pay somebody else's bills or do anything else. Money was donated to my account. That's why we got a little abrupt at a meeting a few months ago where money decided to move out of our accounts before we knew it to be paying for different things, to go to different people. The money's mine. Somebody sent it to me. Use it for your account. That's it.
I mean, wheeling is just, in my opinion, just a way of laundering money. I mean, it's a way of getting it to a specific source or a specific person, you know, because there are restrictions in place which prevent that person from contributing it directly. You know, if Company A wanted me to have it, they would send it to me directly, and if Company A wanted to give me, you know, the $300, they'd send it to me directly. But it's a way of them getting me more than the $300. You know, it's a way of, it's really the restrictions. The cap means nothing if you're going to allow money to be wheeled in, you know, from the same company.
Well, then go back to the thing of zero contributions. You eliminate all of it.
Yeah, but then you open up a whole host of other problems. Why not just say no wheeling and $300 contributions and you eliminate
all of it? I think you're violating the individual's right to have say over his own account. I don't think that's right. Now you're impinging upon my constitutional right.
But this is what I
won't go for you then. That's fine. But from now on then going forward, nobody raises money into their account for the year they're going to run.
But again, you're limited.
Well, because now you're playing, now he's playing a game. Let me get money into my account to dish it out. Keep the money. The money stays in your account for you to run. I don't want to give somebody else more money. I'm going to give my own money. Next year, I'm going to write a check to Carl Manor's campaign. Again, out of Matt and Leah Carrick's account. Not out of campaign for Matt Carrick. Campaign for Matt Carrick's money belongs in Matt Carrick's account. Guess what? If there was a few more dollars in my account this year, I'd be able to pay a bill that I owe. Some money moved out of my account, and I can't pay that bill. Now what do I do? And you know what's going on with it. Now I don't have the money to pay that account. I should always have something in there so in case something like that happens, I can pay it. It's my account. My name's on it. I owe money. I just think it's fair. If it's written against me and I did it, I should pay it. It should come out of my campaign fund. I shouldn't be able to write checks out of my own account to somebody else to pay bills. I can't write out of that account to pay my mortgage. What am I going to have, $13,000 in there and decide to write hey, I'm gonna write a check to my mortgage company, because I got campaign money. No, hold on. I know things that go on, and I know people write checks out of campaign accounts for certain bills. Politics is bullcrap. I'm sorry, government is bullcrap. Keep the money legal, keep it where it belongs, do the right thing. Too much, and it's never, he said before, it's never gonna be perfect. We're gonna make something, somebody's gonna find a way to dig a hole underneath it and do something different. They said it at that meeting the other night too.
I know.
If I know that there is $2 in my account right now, okay, there's $2 and it's staying there. Okay, I'm not writing out to nobody if I need to do $2 in my account when I'm running, if I'm running again, if I so choose, or somebody asks me to do it again, then I'm gonna have that money. That's the way I think this should be. Wheel, and it's just, he's right. Another way of laundering money.
You know, why have a limit if you're going to allow someone to easily exceed that limit? I mean, it's very easy to exceed that
limit. And thus the zero contribution.
But you need some money to run your campaign.
Well,
you need some. So let's be an honest person.
You
put a number on it.
Well,
wait, use it.
You're right. However, that woman with zero contributions raised $39,000. So it can be done. You have a hot tub?
Me?
He doesn't have the legs for it.
Oh.
I only got $2, I can't buy a hot tub.
No,
I know where you're going with her.
I'm saying, I mean, it's doable. Obviously it's doable, but she did it. And I'm sure there are others that have done it. Maybe not to the extent that she has. But it's doable.
But so now, we're picking one. When we have 120 to go through, we're picking the one from Fairlawn that is able to do it. The majority of these ordinances all took in some kind of a number. He's what you would call a unique type of a person. She was able to raise money her way. Okay?
I would say most had at least 300, and some had a little bit more.
There are at least 3-4 in Bergen County that have zero.
Yeah, but
How many seven of you?
Well,
how many we have?
No, Bergen, there was...
No, there's only one, doesn't it?
Yeah, there wasn't that many.
But
statewide, most did at least, I mean, 3 was the conservative number.
We all seem to be okay with it. We just don't seem to be okay with that word wheeling. And that's what stirred us all up. And unfortunately, Carl, that's what set us all on different sides of the table 3 months ago.
Well, what I had said to, you know, the best defense to, you know, to this is what I said to, when I was debating this two or 3 years ago, is to elect those who are honest. I mean, you know, elect someone who's not going to be influenced by campaign contribution, whether it's a dollar or whether it's $1,000. And really, that's the best defense to the hiring of a professional who's not competent based upon a campaign contribution. I mean, that's not always going to happen. You've got honest people, and then you've got certain people who are not going to be so honest and who are going to really maybe be influenced by a campaign contribution. So I think you have to have something in place, because at some point, you know, we're not going to be here, and that time may be sooner, that time may be later, but at some point you're going to have, you know, six council people that are different than a different mayor, and you have to put, in my opinion, you have to put something in place that's going to not only call for who's there today or take into account who's there today, but also take into account who may be there in the future.
You're setting the guidelines for the future. Making, trying to be every person honest. Everybody on an equal playing field, doing the same thing, believing that they're doing the same thing and doing the right thing.
So, I think that's, you know, we're not going to have, obviously, an agreement on that,
but that's something that we can put in, and that's something that the council can decide, hey, I don't like this. There's 6 of us up there. I'm not agreeing with it. Or it could sit in this room right now and say, one person says yes and 2 people say no, 2 people say yes and 1 person says no. But I guess, are we doing a majority when building this thing?
You have to, because if you can't have 3 people that agree, yeah. So, you know, I think we move, this is why I say let's figure out where we have common ground, and this is why I say, you know, if I worked off of this,
Personally, I think what we're doing is the right thing, is taking it piece by piece and talking about it.
Right.
You know, because you can't just put pen to paper and say, this is what we're doing. You're individual, that's an autonomous individual.
Right.
Come to this table from different perspectives.
Coming from this table, putting three things together, there's only three people that can put it together.
Right.
I understand.
He can have his insight, but as far as putting it on paper, it's really the three of us to decide.
But you have to have that discussion.
Right.
You just can't stop writing this stuff.
This is what we're doing now.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
I mean, this is a discussion with three people that have to write an ordinance up.
And I'm agreeing to that, but if we don't talk about it.
Right, I love talking about it. I all of a sudden got a second wind right now.
No, it's an interesting subject, you know, it's an interesting subject, and it's, you know, it's something that, we're doing something that no one in Dumont, you know, has ever thought to do this, in the same fashion. And, you know, we're gonna be.
I love the part you're running that is going against you right now.
Yeah, you know, listen, I'm very comfortable, you know.
If you can't win on your morals, then why are you even bother doing it?
Well, that's it, I've always, you know, you always do what's right, and, you know, the word, this is a small town, word gets out, and in my opinion, let me tell you something, come November, or you know, early November, or late October, you know, when I'm getting 15 of these things from the county, from the state, from I don't even read our own stuff, you know, that's the God's honest truth, I'll see something, you know, from your campaign last year, you know, the fourth thing or the third thing, whoop, right in the garbage.
The first thing in the garbage, I'm talking
about. I don't even read it, and you know, it's overkill. For a local election, that's overkill.
I'd like to recommend that we put together a section on definitions.
Okay.
Because I think if you're going to identify, or mention, you know, PPLs and PACs and CPCs,
Didn't we say we weren't going to use tax, or put in tax, or?
Well, it's not in the state statute, but every document that this citizens group has offered it, has it mentioned.
Well, those are parts even we spoke last time.
Yeah.
That we weren't really into that, so I mean, those are parts that we're just going to pull out.
But when you talk about money coming in and going out to a candidate, you better identify who is not eligible. That's what I'm saying.
What do you mean by that?
We just went through the whole discussion of yield.
Right.
Entities giving money to that candidate. If you're eliminating that money, where's that money coming from? Again, you know, if CWA has candidate to candidate, union to union, where they'll have a group of union workers who are not on doors for it. That's an in-kind contribution. The time that they're spending putting out their literature has a value to them. If they...
What value?
The value of their time when they're not knocking on those doors.
But it's not a paid value. There's no dollar number on that.
If they give you a contribution, there is.
If the union itself does it.
No, if the union goes to a PAC...
Well, that was... What was it, number 7, where they said that was legal for unions to do that? Isn't that what just got overturned?
No.
That was part of it, because they were saying that the unions weren't able to do it.
They were treating the unions as a single entity.
Right.
So that was the issue there. My question is, if you don't, you know, if you don't define who these entities are and whether or not they are able to contribute, then, you know, how do you know?
Well, let me ask you this question, because it didn't happen to me last year, so maybe it could happen to somebody else's. And I'm a union carpenter for 30 years. None of my guys from Local 15 went knocking around on any of these stores in Dumont. Nor, when they asked me, you know, do you want, I said, no, no, no. We have our own people in town, and we're going to do our own, you know, in-house knocking on doors.
Did CWA knock for you?
Huh?
CWA? Communication Workers of America.
Did they knock for me?
Did they have people knock on doors, yeah. When they knocked in town, they were here.
And they knocked for me?
They knocked for the whole Democratic ticket. Not you in particular, but you as part of the ticket.
I was part of my own ticket. I wasn't part of the ticket what they were reading when my name was put on their ticket.
I bet you you are.
I wasn't, because unless I missed that interview at home or left a piece of paper that wasn't there. The only person I seen campaign with us was Julie O'Brien, Vernon, Mike McCarthy and his partner. I don't remember anybody else coming into town knocking on the door. I don't know if they knocked on yours or whatever.
It was GOTV. When they go out with GOTV, they do that.
I don't know that they did it last year.
I don't think they did it last year.
No, they did. Ask Ellen, she was the one who coordinated. That's all I'm asking. You know, I think we need to kind of give definitions of these entities. As they do, you know, in the state statute. But again, that's not everything that's necessary.
Just so we know, we were trying to build a municipal statute.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
And then ours could be unique from everybody else.
Absolutely.
Well, the one that I tailored for you guys last week.
I couldn't read yours.
This one?
Yeah.
He's got that attorney handwriting. He's like a doctor.
The one that I...
Can you read it? I couldn't read it. I got this Dumont, that was it.
I got my kid to read it for me.
You know, to me, take a look at this, tell me what you can't read and I'll, you know, shoot me an email, let me know what you're having trouble reading. And then what I'm gonna do, I mean, this says everything that I've said tonight, but my position on wheeling, paragraph D, the amount of $300, the fact that I tried to tailor this to really focus on Dumont as opposed to anywhere else. I'm not concerned about anywhere else. I'm concerned about this town. And there is a provision in here, subsection, I believe, 5, deals with wheeling. I'm very comfortable with that language, that the model...
I think we really should take a look at D again, because...
Which one, Paul?
D.
Okay. 1D?
Yeah. Because if you have 4 candidates running, you're going to run into a problem. On any side. If you have that as an aggregate.
No, I'm not saying as an aggregate.
That's what it says here. Entity in an aggregate may not annually contribute for any purpose in excess of $2,500 to all Dumont candidates.
Okay.
You have 4 candidates running. You're at a disadvantage.
At 300 a candidate, that's 1,200. And even if you do per election cycle, that's $2,400.
So if you do a primary and election...
I'm just saying, you know, that's something up for discussion. I mean,
I'm just saying, we did... in the past, have 4 candidates up.
I would love that ticket, I know.
So but you don't want to put yourself at a disadvantage.
No, but that still is $100 under the cap, even if you do it per election cycle, which is the other thing we need to talk about. What the panel had suggested was per election cycle. That's primary, and that's the general election. We don't have
a special election if there is one.
And a special election if there is one. We can follow that, we can modify that, we can do, you know, whatever you guys are comfortable doing. You know, typically the way it's worked, we haven't had opposition for primaries.
That's what I was just going to say.
But
154 votes in a primary last year.
Yeah. I mean, typically you don't
have... You want to spend a lot of money on a primary?
Well, here's this is today, you know, here, and this is what you need to think about. This is today. We typically, both sides don't have opposition for primaries. So the question would naturally be asked, well, why do you need that kind of money for a primary? That may not be the case tomorrow, or, you know, in 2 years. You go to a town like Denville, where my brother-in-law is a Republican councilman. So you can imagine the discussions we have at the... But...
Thanksgiving.
Listen, to me, I'm middle of the road. I'm not left-wing, I'm not right-wing. I'm like middle of the road. I have some, you know, I have some very conservative ideas. I have some very, you know, more liberal, you know, ideas when it comes to some things. He's right-wing. But anyway, I digress. In Denville, they really never worry about the general election. They're almost never opposed. Where they get their opposition and where they really need to dig in with the signs and, you know, the tchotchkes and going door-to-door is in a, they always have a fierce primary challenge. So that's the only, just food for thought, you know. Theirs is almost 180, you know, 180 degrees different than ours. So, but so think about whether you want to do per election cycle, or whether you want to do, you know, whether you want to do per just for the general election or per year.
What happens if you raise X amount of dollars in your primary and you don't use it?
Then it's there for you.
What? Your election?
The general election. And then that, technically that would raise, you know, if you're looking at a maximum $300 cap, you know, and you're comfortable with that and you feel anything over and above that might influence somebody's vote, then you would want to go per election cycle. Because that would raise the cap to $600, especially if you think you're not going to have a primary, or, you know, for the most part, 2 months never going to have, as it never has, really, primary battle.
I guess that's what I was against.
Okay, so you're looking for per election cycle.
Right.
Or per year.
Right.
So just, so how do you feel about that?
Election cycle.
Okay.
That's just my opinion. It's just another way to put more money in your account.
Again, you said you're looking into the future. We don't know what's going to happen in the future. We may wind up at one point having primaries where you're going to have two candidates running for a seat. I'd love to see that. I really would.
I'd love to see that, too.
Yeah.
I'd love to see that, too.
So you really can't limit that, I don't think, anyway, based on what we're doing today, as versus the future.
All right, and that's in subsection D, but I mean, as far as you're concerned, Carl, you know, I think in the aggregate we'd still be okay. Even if you do it per cycle, as opposed to per year, if you're going to limit it to three.
That's another question,
Joe. Yes, why?
So you got two people, two Democrats running, two Democrats running for primary.
Mm-hmm.
A and B, C and D. A and B win. C and D lose. C and D still has money in their account. Then what do you do? And normally, they, if I'm hearing this right from different towns, they always throw their vote towards that Democrat, A and B. What do you do with that money?
Send it back if you're going to prohibit wheeling. If they're done, you know, in other words, if they're...
Then that's something I want to put.
Yeah.
Something to put in. If you're not going to do it, then it has the money.
Well, I mean, if it's a one-shot...
Well, wait a minute. That money does not have to go back. Mm-hmm. It could be given to a charity. It could be distributed another way.
It just cannot go to
another
a campaign. Cannot go to another candidate.
Again, I think that's you know... You're restricting the person's right to have a say in what he's doing.
But we just put a number on it. If there's $1,700 left in that guy's campaign, okay, we put a $300 limit on it, and he throws his support towards candidate A and B, you should be able to take that $1,700 and throw it into their campaign.
I disagree.
That's just throwing more money. Then
why? Well, I mean, honestly, the cynic in me says that you have somebody run on a primary, you know, run against...
Eric, nobody's going to put their ass out there and run on a primary, go out there, knock on doors to lose. Believe me. You've all done this.
Yeah.
No. You're going to waste your time to lose? Come on. Be realistic.
Yeah.
You
I mean, like...
You're going to go out and knock on doors to lose? You think you were running against a new Democrat?
You can think of so many variables. Honestly, you
I'm
really
just
can.
Looking...
You can think of so many variables.
Outside the box. Inside the box,
and
outside the box.
The reality is, we all ran. We know what it's like to run.
Yeah.
You're going to put your time and effort to lose. I don't think so. Listen, knowing you and knowing Harry, you say, you know what? I'll go to the ball field. I'll coach the kids.
Right. Right. Yeah.
You
mean,
I know you wouldn't. I wouldn't. I'd take a stained glass class instead of going knocking on doors.
All right. I
mean, it's the voice.
No, listen.
It's
throw it out there. You know, throw it out there. You got what I want to do, guys. This is where I'm at.
Right.
Okay? I don't know that anything that's been said tonight has really changed my mind, except as I've said, I'm grappling with retro versus perspective. So take a look at it, you know, work off of this, don't work off of this, but let's get some ideas going and let's get something, you know, let's start hammering this out.
You want to have it for the public meeting in June?
Probably, no, what I want to do is I want to have a special session, first week of June.
January.
June, yeah, first week of June, we have January in my mind, first week of June, present it to the council, and then have, the vote take place at the public session. This way they can digest it, they can, you know, pick it apart, they can do what they want to do, and they have, you know, we're not just sticking in front of them and saying.
Well, the first of June.
Is a Tuesday.
Tuesday, and we have, Gary Vincent coming to talk about credit.
A what call, I'm sorry?
Credit.
All right, so, I mean, we could just throw this in.
And debt, you know, and debt loans.
Okay, so we're there anyway.
Do nothing on the second, though, all right?
No, second's a Wednesday.
Wednesday.
That's my son's birthday.
Okay, so we can, you know, tie it into that, and then.
23rd, we have the high school graduation. That's out.
Well, I mean, we have our public meeting on the 15th. We can, you know, we can hand this out on the first, you know, put it on the agenda on the first, and that's it. And we've met our time goal of June. Really, I would prefer May, but, you know, June's not the end of the world.
It's not.
Yeah. Anybody else have anything else, or? Yeah, no, I just want to make sure that. You good?
Our other two resolutions that we did, we talked about there.
Well, the dog ordinance, the parks and playgrounds, I mean, for the reason that Carl has, you know, has set forth at the prior meetings, I happen to agree with him 100%. I don't know that we want to move that out, you know, just, I don't know that it makes sense to. And then we have the landlord tenant, well, that was the only other one. So, Carl, your position hasn't changed on the parks and playgrounds?
Well, if you're on the subcommittee, that's the recommendation. So we'll get, one more.
Dog runs or dog park?
Well, that's what I thought we had talked about, I thought that's kind of why I threw it back out, I thought we were looking for a space or.
You know, it's up to Harry whether he wants to bring it to the council. I mean, you know, I made my comments, you made your comments, and I made his comments.
All right, we'll bring it to the council, see if they have any,
You know, whatever.
We have to find a spot, you know.
I would suggest that you have two people and form a subcommittee and have them look at sites that are available in town, two, three sites, maybe, you know, and move from there. You know, I think coming back and saying, well, this is not workable, and give a reason why it's not workable, and say, well, this is an alternative.
Well, I'm 100%, but I don't want to have all parks, but I'd love to have a park around.
You know, I mean.
So they can walk.
You saw, you know, just walking through there, there's no way to get 50 feet. I'm sorry, okay, how you walk?
I agree.
You know, don't 50 feet.
No, motion to open up to the public.
Oh, I'm sorry. Motion to open to the public.
Second, offered by Karen, seconded by myself. Mr. Chen, anything?
Kai Chen, 90 Teak Road. I recall at the last meeting, the mayor had some reference material, and there was an agreement to put it on the website for interested folks to.
Right.
Download and peruse. As of this afternoon, I did not see it.
I believe the minutes have to be approved before that gets published.
Okay.
And if the minutes were approved tonight.
Minutes were approved tonight, okay.
It'll be there.
Appreciate that.
I mean, there was a misunderstanding, I guess, on my part also, and I wasn't aware of that, I thought it was going to be.
Okay.
So, if we can get that cap on the website. Okay, anything else?
That's it, Chen.
Okay. Motion to close to the public.
Soon.
Karen, seconded by Manna, all in favor?
Aye.
Motion to adjourn?
Motion.
Manna, Karen, all in favor? Aye. All right, guys.